Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salam ala ashrafil mursaleen. Sayyidina Habibina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Dear all brothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, today we have one special program. And you are with me, Amir Azizi, in this session, in this special session, as named as exclusive interview with Dr. Zakir Naik, or Dr. Zakir Abdul Karim Naik. Okay, so first of all, it is a very pleasure for me to have this prominent speaker, this famous speaker in the world. As we know already, we know, alhamdulillah, so all praises be due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us, for blessing us times to times, and alhamdulillah, we are hoping to have this kind of special discussion with Dr. Zakir Naik, alhamdulillah. And praise be to Allah and peace be upon him, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. As we know, Islam always teaches us about the rightful things to be done. And alhamdulillah, we are now with Dr. Zakir Naik. And mashallah, I used to be very, very ambitious and very admired to Dr. Zakir Naik. Alhamdulillah, right now, Dr. Zakir, alhamdulillah, we are here. Assalamu alaikum, Doctor.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
And how are you, Doctor, today?
Alhamdulillah.
So first of all, I'd like to congrats to you for receiving the award of Ma'al Hijrah from the government of Malaysia. So first of all, before I came here, I really like to know about Dr. Zakir Naik. As we know, he is a famous public speaker and a founder and president of the Islamic Research Foundation, or IRF, which is based in Dubai, right?
Mumbai,
India, alhamdulillah. So, doctor used to be a medical doctor. You have the background of medicine, but right now you are a da'i, who are calling the da'wah, I mean the worker of da'wah, one of the famous workers of da'wah in the world right now, right nowadays, as we know, the public knows. Okay, now doctor, can you share with us a bit, how did you start the da'wah compared to your background in medicine? Yes.
Alhamdulillah. والصلاه والسلام على رسول الله وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين اما بعد اعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ومن احسن قولا ممن دعا الى الله وعمل صالحا قال انني من المسلمين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقده من لساني يفقهوا قولي As you told that I have done my professional training in the field of medicine
yes
but in 1987 when I met Sheikh Ahmed Didat I was inspired by him and when I met him I started doing dawah and he was the person who changed me from a doctor of a body to a doctor of a soul.
Yeah.
So while I was doing my medical studies, I chose to become a doctor thinking that it is the best profession for a human being. And it is a good profession. But when I found a better profession, as I started my talk, and I quoted the verse of the Quran from Surah Fussilat, chapter 41, verse 33, which says, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَالَ مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا قَالَ إِنَّنِي مُسْلِمٌ Who is better in speech than one who invites to the way of thy Lord, works righteousness and says that I am a Muslim. So when I found a better profession, that's how I changed from a doctor of a body to a doctor of soul. And when I asked, I mean, it was a desire of my mother that I should become a heart specialist. And she was inspired by Dr. Chris Barnard. Dr. Chris Barnard was the first heart specialist who transplanted a heart into a human being.
Okay.
So my mother wanted me to be like someone like Chris Barnard, who also comes from South Africa. So when I asked my mother, that would you want me to become like Sheikh Didat or Dr. Chris Barnard, she said both.
Both?
And later on when I got involved in the field of Dawah, and then I asked after I gave talks and I had debate, later on after a few years when I asked her, then would you want me to become like Sheikh Ahmed Didat, who also comes from South Africa, or would you want me to become like Dr. Chris Barnard? She said, I can sacrifice 1,000 Chris Barnard for one Sheikh Didat. So Sheikh Didat is the person who inspired in the field of Dawah, and that's how I took Dawah as a full-time profession.
So did you meet the Sheikh Ahmed Didat?
Yes, the first time I met him was 1987, and then 1988 he has come to India a couple of times. I've been a few times to South Africa, so he was my inspiration, my mentor.
For some of my cliques in Malaysia, we said Dr. Zakir Naik is the second Ahmed Didat. But right now, how are we going to the second Dr. Zakir Naik? Any comment, Doctor?
Alhamdulillah, we have a school by the name of Islamic International School, where we train the children from the age of 2.5. We teach them Arabic and English as a language. We teach them both. By the time they reach standard 5, they can understand the Quran. By the time they reach standard 9 or 10, they can translate to a great extent.
Oh.
So Arabic is a compulsory language along with the formal education that is of the Cambridge Board, the UK. We teach them Quran, Hadith, Sharia, Fiqh. One third of the students, we train them to be Hafiz. And we have more than 100 Hufaz in our school. Martial arts is compulsory. By the time they reach standard 5, they have to be black belt. And Alhamdulillah, my children are studying in the school, and my son also, mashallah, is from the same school, and he's also Hafiz al-Quran. Both my daughters are Hafiz al-Quran. He's been giving lectures from the age of 8, and now he's 19 years old. And he's been giving lectures, mashallah, to audiences of thousands and 30,000, 50,000 people, mashallah.
He himself?
Yes, my son. And my son was there with me last year when I came, about 1 year back in September and October 2012. Even he had given a speech at Shah Alam Mosque, where there were more than 15,000 people.
Okay.
Mashallah. So we have in the next future generation, not only my son, many students from the Islamic International School who can quote verse from the Quran, who can give lectures. So in this school, we train the children from the age of 3.5, 4, how to give public speeches.
Yes.
And they are trained in giving lectures in large audiences of hundreds of people, of thousands of people. So we train from a young age, and that's how they get bold. And we teach them even comparative religion, not only Quran, Hadith and Sharia fiqh. We also teach the Bible, the Christian scriptures, the Jewish scriptures, the Hindu scriptures, so that they become daif.
Inshallah.
So inshallah, we have people, the next generation will have many people who would inshallah be full-time daif.
Mashallah, I'm really impressed. How did a doctor of body change to doctor of soul?
Yes,
this is what you call transformation. But at the same time, you are going to be both. Mashallah, my brothers and sisters, doctor have shared with us about his children. I mean, how to be Dr. Zakir Naik, the second Dr. Zakir Naik, mashallah.
Better than me, inshallah. Better than me, inshallah. Because my son is Hafiz al-Quran, I'm not Hafiz al-Quran. He knows Arabic as a language, I know very little. His English pronunciation is better. So inshallah, I expect my son and the children of IS to be much better than me, inshallah.
How long do we, I mean, all Muslims, if they are going to know, how long does it take to make us very proficient, very professional, to have both mastering in Quran and Hadith, and at the same time, we are specialists in our background. We are a medical doctor, we are an engineer, we are also a lecturer in, let's say, some mathematics.
If you really ask me, how long does it take you to become a doctor or engineer? You pass your school,
yes,
and then you go to junior college,
yeah.
Then you go to university. Mm-hmm. Similarly, if you want to be a very good guy, similarly, you can do it simultaneously. So in our school, our motto is education for both the worlds. So while they are learning the formal education, mathematics, English, history, science, geography,
right,
and the degree they get from the Cambridge Board, not a Muslim degree, not an Indian degree, it's a recognized degree. By the time, while they're learning the formal education, simultaneously they're learning Quran, Hadith, Sharia, fiqh. This is the best. So that simultaneously, from childhood, the dawah is ingrained.
In your,
and what we expect, that out of the students that pass from the school, 50% would go into the mainstream, become doctors, engineers, lawyers, businessmen, and 50% would become da'is, full-time da'is, maybe full-time Islamic teachers, maybe
yes,
muhaddith, maybe mufassir. And what we expect, that the 50% who are better in results should become da'is. The 50% lower category would become doctors and engineers. What we have today in our society, that if your child fail, then you put him in a madrasa and make him Hafiz al-Quran. What we require is the best of the ummah to represent the deen. So in our school, those who get high marks, they go to the Islamic field. Those who get low marks, they become doctors and engineers.
Sure. You have recited earlier the verse of Allah, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. While at the same time, my brothers and sisters, we can see some of us are really shy to talk about Islam, to teach about Islam, to become, because why? We are afraid of doing any mistake. We are not going to make any mistake. We are too afraid of doing any mistake. So doctor, is it right for us to not doing any mistake, or do we have to learn from the mistakes?
You said that some of us are shy. I would say most of us are shy, not some, most of us. And when we ask people, why don't you do dawa, they say, no, unless we don't get good knowledge and they want to become like Sheikh Ahmed Dida, then they start doing dawa. Yes. I tell them, a beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, a beloved Prophet said, balighuni wala aya, propagate even if you know one verse. So when you're doing dawa, at least what you know properly, you can propagate. And everyone knows that there's one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everyone knows that Muhammad is the Prophet. At least speak. At least tell your friends there's one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you start doing dawa, whatever little bit knowledge you have, as long as you know it is correct, you should start propagating. And the moment you start propagating and conveying the message to the others, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps on giving you more knowledge. And that's how, like, I have not gone to any Darul Uloom. I have studied in the normal school, in the normal college, into a medical college. I was inspired by Sheikh Ahmed Didad, and hearing his tapes, I got inspired and started speaking. Yeah. And but now Allah helped me, and that's how. And if you know my background, I was a stammerer. In childhood, I used to stammer. If anyone used to ask me, what is your name? My name is Zakir. I used to stutter. But the moment I started doing dawah, I realized when I spoke with non-Muslim, my stammering vanished. When I speak with Muslim, again it came back. Mm-hmm. So it's Allah's help. And I could have dreamt of becoming the best doctor in the world, the best surgeon in the world in my dreams.
Yes.
In your dreams, you can dream anything. But I could not have dreamt of speaking in front of 25 people because I should stammer.
Yes.
And now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it possible that I speak to thousands of people at one time, even hundreds million. Of thousands, and the largest gathering I've addressed is 1 million people.
1 million people.
It's in India, in Kishanganj, close to the border of Bihar. 1 million people live. So it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ni'mah and His grace that if you strive in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says in the Quran, Surah Ankabut, chapter number 29, verse number 69, if you strive in His way, He will open up your pathways.
And doctor, back to our discussion about Islam. Okay, we are Muslims, the Muslim brothers and sisters. Allah says there shall be no compassion in religion, or no force in religion, I mean in becoming a Muslim. So doctor, La ikraha fid din. So can you explain a bit to our audience and the viewers, what does it mean?
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2 verse number 256, Allah says La ikraha fid din, there is no compulsion religion. Mm-hmm. And the verse continues, truth stands out clear from error.
Yes.
So in Islam we cannot force anyone to accept the deen at the point of the sword, at the point of the gun. You can't force anyone to accept the deen.
Yes.
What we have to do, we have to convey the message. But that does not mean you cannot force, that means you don't do dawa. The complete verse is like Rafid Deen, there is no compulsion. Religion, truth stands out clear from error. But if you hold the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will take you from darkness to light. If you hold the hand of the Satan, He will take you from light to darkness. So you have to convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no compulsion in religion, but that does not mean you don't convey the message. It is the duty of every Muslim that he conveys the message of Islam to the non-Muslims and clarifies what is Islam. But we can't force anyone to accept Islam. Islam is a religion of choice.
Yes.
You can't force anyone. It's a logical religion. Mm-hmm. It is the best way of life. It is the din al-haq. And Islam is the solution to the problem of humanity. Mm-hmm. The only religion which has the solution to the problem of humankind is Islam.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Doctor, mashallah, Islam. We will share more about Islam and Islam as the way of life, my brothers and sisters, inshallah. But we will share more after we take a break for a while, inshallah. See you after this. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. We meet again in our special session or in special interview with Dr. Zakir Naik, one of the receivers of Tokoh Ma'al Hijrah Peringkat Kebangsaan 1435 Hijri. And just now we have discussed about a bit on Islam. And when we look to, we ponder about the verse of Allah. Allah said in the Quran, La ikraha fid din. Dr. Zakir Naik has explained a bit, but we want to know more about Islam. As when we know Islam, Doctor, when we say it about Islam is considered as the most ideal religion in this world. which is the only religion blessed by Allah. So how do we Muslim, doctor, especially the Muslim all around the world, especially in Malaysia right now, the Malaysian Muslims, how should we understand about Islam is the best religion or is the only blessed religion by Allah?
Islam comes from the root word salam, which means peace. Yes. It's also derived from the Arabic word silm, which means to submit your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islam in short means is peace acquired by submitting will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Islam is the only religion, as Allah says in the Quran, Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse number 19, Inna dina indallah al-Islam. The only religion acceptable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Islam. So Islam is the best way of life, and Islam has a solution to the problems of humanity. Today we find that whatever problem that humanity is facing today, Islam has a solution, and we Muslims should be proud of it. Yeah. Unfortunately, we Muslims are apologetic. Today we find in the Muslim world that the Muslims are shy to call themselves Muslims.
Yeah.
Because you see in the media, the international media, the radio station, the television channels, the newspapers, we find there is virulent propaganda regarding Islam. We find that they're criticizing Islam, and we Muslims are apologetic to call ourselves Muslims. That is the reason Allah says in the Quran in Surah An-Nahl chapter 16 verse 125, Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah wal mawzit al hasna wajadun bil lati ahsan. Invite all the way of the Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. It is the duty of every Muslim that it should convey the message of Islam to the others, and it is the duty even of the people in Malaysia that they should see to it that besides practicing Islam, they should convey the message of Islam to the non-Muslims. Because Malaysia is a multicultural country, and there are a large number of non-Muslims. It is the duty of the Malaysians to present the true picture of Islam to the non-Muslims, with reason, logic and science.
So far, alhamdulillah, Islam in Malaysia is considered in the our federal FC, federal constitution. Islam is the federal religion. But in a way, when we Muslims who doesn't want, some of us who don't want to perform Islam, or don't want to admit they are Muslim.
Practice Islam.
Yes, perhaps the propaganda, I mean, are you Muslim? Hey, how come a Muslim do this and that? I mean, the bad deeds, not performing the good deeds, as Allah always asks us to perform the whatever that He commands, right? But doctor, how do we solve this problem? I mean, the Muslims, they are supposed to be very lucky. They're supposed to be very proud of Islam, as you said earlier. How do we convince them, the Muslims?
Regarding how do we convince the Muslims who are not practicing Islam, is we have to take each aspect of it and try and prove that this is the best way of life. Unfortunately, we find that many of the Muslims consider that Islam is a backward religion, it's outdated. So we have to prove to these people who are so-called namesake Muslims that Islam is the best way of life with reason, logic and science. I've given a talk on Quran and modern science. And if you put this test of science to any other religion besides Islam, any other religious scripture besides the Quran, it will fail. So when we show that what science has discovered today, 40 years back, 50 years back, 100 years back, Quran has mentioned 14 years ago, this boosts up the morale of the Muslims. So those Muslims who have gone away from the deen and don't practice, we should get them closer to the deen with reason, logic and science. And we should prove to them that Islam is the best way of life, Islam is the most scientific religion, and Islam has the solution to the problems of mankind. So whatever they are not following, pick up that aspect and prove to them logically that this is the best way of life.
Do we need, doctor, do we need any scientific approach to prove the authenticity? Meaning, some, perhaps, I don't know, we can say this, some of the Muslims which are educated, they are becoming educated Muslim brothers, they are engineers, they are also doctors, they are lecturers, professors, and so on and so forth. But sometimes they will be only accept Islam, or Islam as the way of life, my brothers and sisters. Islam will be accepted by them only when they are the scientific approach. I mean, only when they are the proof how to follow the Sunnah. Yes, the Sunnah is true, the Quran is true, and then I will follow. If not, I will only, my name is only Muslim, but I'm not going to perform any Islamic teachings. What's your comment, Doctor?
As far as convincing those so-called Muslims who are so much impressed with science and technology, yeah, with modern education and far away from the Quran and Sunnah, mm-hmm, you have to get them by proving that Quran and Islam is the most scientific book and the most scientific religion. And as I told you earlier, I've given the talk on Quran and modern science. Mm-hmm. Quran is not a book of science, S-C-I-E-N-C-E, but it's a book of signs, S-I-G-N-S. It's a book of ayats. And there are more than 6,000 ayats in the glorious Quran, out of which 1,000 speak about science. So when these people are educated, they're so impressed with science and technology, when you prove to them that what science has come to know recently, Quran has mentioned 14 years back, they get impressed. Mm-hmm. And they start following Islam. They feel proud of their religion. But for a true Muslim, the ultimate is Quran Hadith. Mm-hmm. It is not science and technology. We can use science and technology to get the non-Muslims closer to Islam or those non-practicing Muslims closer to Islam. But Quran and Hadith is far superior than science. Mm-hmm. It is Quran is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Hadith is the word of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These two are far superior to science, and science hasn't advanced so far to make us understand everything of the Quran.
Yes, correct, Doctor. Some I found some of the professors in the university, my brothers and sisters, some of the professors said that Quran is more scientifically proven. I mean, the statements in the Quran were said more than 1400 years ago, but the scientific, the finding of the scientific things or the data is only found today. Yes, Doctor. Correct. Quran is the miracle books of Allah, the miracle book for us, for Muslims. But in a way, how should we learn the Quran and the Sunnah? As the beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam used to say that I left to you two things, right? The first thing is Kitab Allah or the Quran, and the second one is the Sunnah wa Sunnati Nabiyihi. I mean, the tradition of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, peace be upon him. So Dr. Zakir, we would like to share in your experience, how do we Muslims, how should we learn the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, without regarding to the schools. I mean, some of us sent the children to the school, I mean the Islamic school and the secondary school of Islam and so on and so forth. How do we Muslims in general?
As for a general Muslim to understand the Quran and the Sunnah, I always advise them that if they know Arabic as a language, it is the best. If they understand Arabic as a language and if they read the Quran and say Hadith, they can understand directly. But if they don't know Arabic as a language, they should read the translation of the Quran in the language they understand best. If they know Malay, they should read the Malay translation of the Quran. If they know English, they should read the English translation of the Quran. If they know Urdu, they should read the Urdu translation of the Quran. If they know French, they should read the French translation of the Quran. You should read the translation of the Quran in the language you understand the best, mm-hmm, and implement on the message. The Quran is the source of guidance throughout your life. And after the Quran, if you read the Hadith, mm-hmm, the more important Hadith, the Sahih Hadith, yeah, that will teach you the teachings of Islam. And there are very different Hadith. Bukhari is there, Muslim is there, Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim,
yes,
Abu Dawud is there, Tirmidhi is there, Ibn Majah is there. And there are other books, for example, Umdatul Ahkam. Mm. All the Ahkam, the Hadith of Ahkam al-Hukum, that is there. In Bukhari and Muslim is there. So if you read that, you'll come to know the major Hukum in the Deen. You can read Bulughul Maram. So in this way, and what you should do, you should read the various commentaries and tafasirs. You should read the books of the scholars. Mm. You should hear the lectures. Today is the age of science and technology. You can go on the YouTube, you can easily, but see to it you read the books of authentic scholars. Mm-hmm. See to it that you hear the lectures of authentic scholars, those that give lecture based on Quran and Sunnah.
What can I say from your discussion, from your sharing just now, Doctor, is we have to read more. If you want knowledge, more knowledgeable, meaning that we have to read more and learn more. If we know that we have to admit if we are lack of knowledge, so then look for the ustaz and look for the experts to learn more and more. And Dr. Zakir, if just now we said about the Quran and the Sunnah, the tradition, the prophets, the tradition of the Prophet, the Sunnah of the Prophet. So, what else? If we Muslims want to imitate, there are some of us telling that, oh, it's hard. It's very difficult for us to imitate the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. How can I do Qiyamul Layl? Oh, come on, it's too sleepy. It's for me, it's good to have a good rest because I'm going to work tomorrow. What's your comment, Doctor, to imitate?
As far as imitating, the best person to imitate in the world is Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He's the best exemplary role model. Mm-hmm. We should follow his Sunnah. And as far as those Muslims who give excuses that how can I read Qiyamul Layl, that is Tahajjud,
yes,
I feel sleepy, I have to go to work tomorrow, then ask him to sleep a bit early. Don't ask him to sleep late, watch movies and television. Sleep early so that he gets up in time, maybe 1 hour before Fajr, half an hour before Fajr. Read Qiyamul Layl. But naturally, the total amount of hours he's sleeping should be same, but he should sleep early so that he can get up for Qiyam. Yes. In this way, if you know the various Sunnah of the Prophet and the way he led his life, and you try and emulate the Prophet, that is the best that you can do to lead your life.
Mm-hmm. Inshallah. So the Prophet has left us the best ever. I mean, he's
best
the role
example.
Model, yes, in this world. And Doctor, how about the term of wasatiyah or moderate? I know the audience, fellow audience, and the viewers, you who are watching right now the program, we have heard the word wasatiyah. In Malaysia, we use the theme of wasatiyah, tonggak kesatuan ummah. So with wasatiyah, we can be united. The strengthen the wasatiyah we have, the strengthen we are in this kind of ummah, ummatul Islamiyah. We are the Muslim ummah. So Doctor, wasatiyah, meaning moderate, is it not to be the best, or is it meaning, what does it mean actually? Is it meaning wasatiyah? I'm doing wasatiyah, so I'm very humble, and you are going to compete me. Go on. I'll say no. You just go. Is it correct?
No, there are various different shades of the word wasatiyah. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 143, mm-hmm, that Allah has made you an ummati wast. A middlemost community, so that you may be a witness over the others and the messenger will be a witness over you. Mm-hmm. So as Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, through him we got the message of Islam, Allah says the ummate wasat means the middlemost community in between. So it's our duty to do dawah, to convey the message of Islam to the non-Muslims. Mm-hmm. So on the day of judgment we can be a witness over them and the messenger will be witness over them. This is one meaning of ummate wasat, a middlemost community. Yeah. The other meaning is that it's a moderate deen. It's a moderate deen, as Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse number 171. La taglu fi dinukum. Do not commit excesses in your religion. Do not commit excesses. But that doesn't mean that you don't follow Islam strictly. Ummate wasat means a middlemost community. You have to follow Islam strictly. That means you have to follow what Allah and His Rasul says. You don't commit excesses. Like someone says that, I want to pray the full day. Mm-hmm. Full day I'll pray, I'll not do any work. So you have to pray, you have to even sleep, you have to eat, you have to fast. So this is wast. And the best example was our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You can't commit excesses in your deen. Uh-huh. It is the best way of life, and how you should lead a balanced life you'll find in the lifestyle of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam.
So inshallah, Doctor, mashallah, I've shared a lot with brother Dr. Zakir Naik today in this session, and my brothers and sisters, fellow audience and the viewers, inshallah, we'll have the second break, inshallah, and we'll meet again after this break, inshallah. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah. Again, my brothers and sisters, we'll meet again in this special interview, or the exclusive interview with Dr. Zakir Naik. And inshallah, we will share more about Islam, about da'wah and so on, about what we do, what we do have, and what do we supposed to have, inshallah. So, Dr. Zakir, when we say about Islam, we talk about Islam as the only religion, as the only blessed religion by Allah, like we said earlier. So, inna deena inda Allah Islam, meaning is there any compulsory for us to teach Islam to non-Muslims? And how about giving da'wah, calling for Islam? Is it only for non-Muslim, or do we have obligated to also give da'wah to Muslims, our brothers, Muslim brothers?
As far as da'wah is concerned, da'wah is an Arabic word which means to call, which means to invite. Yeah. When we speak about Islam to Muslims, the more appropriate word is islah.
Islah.
To repair, to improve. Mm-hmm. Though this word da'wah is used for both, giving Islamic knowledge to Muslims as a non-Muslim, but the more appropriate word when we speak about Islam to Muslims, the more appropriate word is islah. To repair, to improve. And when we speak about Islam to the non-Muslims, it is an invitation, it's a call. So when we speak to non-Muslims about Islam, the more appropriate word is called as da'wah. Mm-hmm. As far as da'wah is concerned, Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse 110, Allah says, Kuntum khaira ummatin ukhrijat linnas. We Muslims, we are the best of people evolved for mankind. Ta'miruna bil ma'rufi wa tanhauna 'anil munkar wa tu'minuna billah. Because we enjoy what is good and we forbid what is wrong and we believe in Allah. Allah is calling us the khaira ummah because we are supposed to enjoy what is good and forbid what is wrong and believe in Allah. If we do not enjoy what is good and if we do not forbid what is wrong, we are unfit to be called as Muslims. So we have to convey the message of Islam. If you find a Muslim who's not practicing Islam correctly, it's your duty that you correct him. At the same time, when you find a non-Muslim, it's your duty that you convey the message of Islam to the non-Muslims. Mm-hmm. And one of the best ways to convey Islam to the non-Muslim is that there are various different strategies. Yeah. Most common strategy used by the Muslims is that you speak 100 good things about Islam to a non-Muslim. Even if the non-Muslim agrees with these 100 things what you have spoken, yet at the back of the mind, he will start thinking, you are the same Muslim who is a fundamentalist. Mm-hmm. You are a Muslim who is a terrorist. You are the people who marry more than one woman. You are the people who subjugate the woman by keeping her behind the veil. These few negative factors at the back of his mind will prevent him from accepting the beauty of Islam. Mm-hmm. That is the reason when I meet a non-Muslim, I ask him upfront, what do you feel is wrong with Islam? With your limited knowledge, whether right or wrong, what do you feel is wrong with Islam? And I make them comfortable. They can criticize Islam, they can speak against the Quran. And after I made them comfortable, they pose about 4 or 5 questions. And these 4 or 5 questions invariably fall in the 20 most common questions asked by non-Muslims. Mm-hmm. In the experience that I have for the past few decades, I've realized that there are about 20 questions which the non-Muslim ask commonly. Oh. And I've written a book on replies to the common questions asked by non-Muslims. And if you know the answer to these common questions with reason, logic and science, even if you cannot convert them, at least you can utilize them. You can remove the animosity which is there in the mind. And it's the duty of every Muslim to convey the message in the best way. And we have got sessions in Bombay. Mm-hmm. Like you asked me earlier, how do you train, Nadai? Yeah. This course, what I told you about the school, was a long-term course of about 15 years. Mm-hmm. But we even have crash courses of about 40 days, where we train adults. And we train them how to convey the message of Islam to non-Muslim. How to quote from the Quran, how to quote from the Hadith, how to quote from the non-Muslim scriptures, from the Bible, from the Quran. It's a technique.
So it's like a course?
It's a course that we have. It's a course of about 40 days.
Mm-hmm. Days.
35 to 40 days, where we train the people how to convey the message of Islam. But the best is the school, where we train them on a very high level. Mm-hmm. This course is a crash course, so that you can convey the message of Islam to the non-Muslims.
So doctor, when you said earlier, just now you said about the frequently asked question by non-Muslims. I think we have found, my brothers and sisters, one of the books written by Dr. Zakir Naik. We have found it in Malaysia. It is sold in Malaysia. Perkara soalan-soalan yang daripada bukan Islam. I mean, doctor, you said earlier about the Islam. And we the believers, we want to become the righteous believers of Allah, of course. But when we talk about Islam to non-Muslim or to the public, there's element of non-viewable. I mean, the Jannah, the Jannah and the Nar, the paradise. I mean, the resurrection day. How do we convince them to believe? Again, it is about the Aqidah of Islam, and again, If we want to know about Islam, how far do you Muslims believe that you are the righteous believers of Allah. So how do we serve this?
As far as making a person believe about Nar, about Jannah, which is difficult scientifically, what I say that if you analyze the Quran today, approximately 80% what the Quran speaks about science can be proved to be 100% correct. About the Big Bang Theory, about geology, about biology, about embryology, about medicine. As I told earlier, that there are more than 1,000 verses in the Quran which speak about science. So 80% suppose what the Quran has mentioned has been proved scientifically to be 100% correct. There may be 20% which is ambiguous, neither right, neither wrong.
Yes.
Science hasn't advanced so far to prove that they're right. Neither can science prove they're wrong. Amongst them, you have this concept of Jannah, you have the concept of Jahannam. So what I say that if 80% is 100% correct, then my logic says that inshallah, even that valid 20% will be correct. When 80% is 100% correct, not even 0.1% is wrong, then my logic says that even that 20% which science hasn't discovered so far about hell, about heaven, even that will be inshallah true. So it's a logical belief. It's a logical belief. And one of them is also about Jahannam and Jannah. This is one way of convincing them. There are other ways of convincing. I have given a talk on this about life after death. That how can you convey? That if there is no concept of life after death, then the concept of good and bad is not there. Unless there's a concept of life after death, then only the question of good and bad is there. Because if there's no akhirah, then why should we be good or why should we be bad? So the reason of this is, for example, I say that I ask a person that is robbing good or bad. Now I happen to be a person who does not who is an atheist, who is non-Muslim, and does not believe in akhirah. You try to prove me, you tell me why, you give me one logical reason why robbing is bad and I stop robbing. With all your logic and all the reason, I am big mafia, hypothetically. I'm a big smuggler. I rob people and I enjoy life. With robbing I can watch movies, I can have food, I can buy a big bungalow. So why it is wrong? Why it is bad? Why is robbing bad? Can you give me a reason why robbing is bad?
Because you have taken the rights of others.
Fine, I've taken rights of others, but by taking, I'm enjoying life. Why is it bad for me?
Well,
it may be bad for him who I'm robbed.
Yeah.
So you have to prove to me, give me one logical reason why robbing is bad and I stop robbing.
What if, doctor, if you said, for example, if you want to become a robber, what if the same goes to you? So
see,
no
one can rob me because I'm a mafia, I told you. I've got 100 bodyguards.
Yeah.
AK-47. You know, so no one can rob me because I'm a mafia, I've got all the guards.
Correct.
So whatever answer, some may say that maybe the police will catch you. See, police cannot catch me because the police in my pocket. The minister's on my payroll. Fine? So they cannot catch me. If you say that, you know, it is against humanity. Who wrote the book called Humanity? So whatever answer you give, it will never be correct. So only way, now we turn sides over. If you are that robber and I am a Muslim.
Okay.
So only way I can prove that robbing is bad is that first to prove to him the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yeah.
And I've given the talk on is the Quran God's word. But I prove the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now once we prove the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only existence of Allah is not sufficient. We know many people who do wrong things, who rob, who rape and lead a very comfortable life and they die. So don't you think they should be punished?
Yes.
The only way they can be punished is the akhirah.
To be penalized, to be punished.
So if a robber robs someone, the only way I can tell him is that in akhirah you'll be punished. So besides the concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there should be a concept of Jannat and Jahannam.
Oh.
If there's no concept of Jannat and Jahannam, you cannot prove robbing is bad, you cannot say cheating is bad, you cannot prove raping is bad. If you are a very famous and a big robber, maybe you can go scot-free here. But Allah says in the Quran in Surah Imran chapter 3 verse 185, Allah says, "Kullu nafsin zaiqatul maut." Every soul shall have a taste of death. And the final recompense will be on the day of judgment. So even if a person goes scot-free here, he'll be held responsible in the akhirah. Suppose you catch Hitler, you know Hitler? He's supposed to be the person who's killed the maximum human being in the world. History tells us he has killed 6 million Jews. Today suppose the police catches Hitler, what punishment can you give him? Maximum, maybe you can kill him once. He has incinerated, burned 6 million Jews. So even if you catch him, you can burn him once. What about the balance 5,999,000 people? But Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 56, Allah says, as to those who reject our signs, we shall cast them into the hellfire, and as often as the skins are roasted, we shall give them fresh skin so that they shall feel the pain. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Akhirah, if he wants to burn Hitler 6 million times, he can do it. If he wants to burn 12 million times, he can do it. So that's the reason, without the concept of Akhirah, Jannat and Jahannam, you will not be able to prove that robbing is bad or these things are bad. Only there has to be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Akhirah and Jannah.
MashaAllah. Well, we Muslim brothers and sisters, my fellow viewers, my brothers and sisters, fellow audience, MashaAllah, when we talk about Islam, we not only talk about, we don't only speak about life in this world. I mean, we live in our country, our beloved country, and while other Muslims, our brothers and sisters, live in this world, but we also talk about a life in hereafter, life after death. Yeah, and we have to be very we have to have iman. I mean, we have to believe about the akhirah, because it is one of the pillars, min arkan al iman. Yes, doctor. And if we now I want Dr. Zakir, if you can share with us about how to govern a country, a Muslim country, based on Islamic terms, I mean Islamic principles. Can we, is there any principles, any teachings, any rulings stated in Islam to govern the bodies, our agencies, our office, how to govern? We Muslims, and we are going to work as Muslim. We are Muslim in ibadah, and we want to be Muslim in work.
As far as how should a country be governed on the basis of Quran and Sunnah,
yes,
there are so many verses in the Quran and the Hadith. Islam believes in Khilafat.
Yes.
If you want the Islamic ruling, yeah, the right ruling is Khilafat, that there is a Khalifa and he follows the Quran and Sunnah. And you have many verses in the Quran and several Hadith which says how the thing, how a country should be ruled. And the best example you have in the Fokhul Farashadin, Hazrat Abu Bakr, Hazrat Umar, Hazrat Usman, Hazrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with them all. They were the best examples. And you see in their lifestyle how they governed the Muslim country and the Quran and Sunnah, that is the best. So Khilafat, if you want Islamic ruling, it's Khilafat, it's not democracy.
Of course, Doctor, what happens today is some of us, brothers and sisters, some of us, the Muslims, when we look at them, when you look at some, let's say for example me, when you, my brothers and sisters, look at me, oh, is he a Muslim? Especially when I don't wear a songkok, we call it songkok, or I don't wear any, the women don't wear a hijab, or the tudung, we call it tudung here. We don't follow what has stated by Allah in Surah An-Nur, verse 31 for women, and verse 30 to the men, right, doctor? But what makes us confused sometimes, some of the Islamic values exist in non-Muslim deeds or non-Muslim practice. The non-Muslim practice is, of course, when you see, oh, is he a Muslim? Are they Muslims? But when we look to Muslims, mashallah, my brothers and sisters, is he a Muslim? I can see, I don't know, when I look to your wear, how did you wear? Mashallah. So we want to know, Dr. Zakir, how do we differentiate about Muslims and the wearing of the Muslims? But doctor, we wait for a while. We will get the answer from the doctor, my brothers and sisters, just after this break. We take a break for a while. Uh, Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala habibillah Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. My brothers and sisters, we meet again in our special session with Dr. Zakir Naik. So to continue our interview, Doctor, just now before we take a break, I said to the audience about Islam sometimes can be seen in non-Muslim practice. And sometimes if you want to find Islam, you want to look for Islam, what Islam is all about, so don't go to Muslims, but go to non-Muslims in few countries, in these particular countries. So what's your comment, Doctor?
I feel the statement is wrong, that if you want to look at Islam, look in the non-Muslims, a totally wrong statement. What you can say, that some of the Muslims are not practicing Muslims. Mm-hmm. And some of the non-Muslims may be following some of the qualities mentioned in the Quran and the Hadith. But Muslim means a person who submits his will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 208, Udkhul fi sinni kaffa, enter into Islam wholeheartedly. So you cannot say that you can find Islam in non-Muslims. Yes, you can find certain values which have been taught by a beloved prophet or mentioned in the Quran in the Muslims. Now, coming to this, as far as a person has to go to Jannah, the criteria of going to Jannah is mentioned in the Quran in Surah Al-Asr, chapter number 103, verse number 1-3, which says, "Wal Asr, inna al-insana fi khusr, illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqq wa tawasaw bis sabr." That by the token of time, man is verily in a state of loss, except those who have faith, those who have righteous deed, those who exhort people to truth, and those who exhort people to patience and perseverance. For any human being to go to Jannah, he requires four things. Iman, mm-hmm. Number two is righteous deed, watawasaw bil haqq, inviting people to truth, doing dawah and islah, mm-hmm. And watawasaw bis sabr, inviting people to patience and perseverance. You may give an example that there are some non-Muslims who are very good, very honest, doing charity, helping the poor. Will they go to Jannah or Jahannam? See, he may be or she may be a non-Muslim who may be very charitable, who may be very kind, who may be helping the poor, but that means they may be having the criteria number two, they may be good in deeds. But if they don't have Iman, and if they don't worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they do not believe Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last and final messenger, it is like me giving an example that when I passed my 10th standard, there were six compulsory subjects. English, mathematics, history, geography, science, and second language. If I get 100 out of 105 subjects and one subject in science if I fail, so do you think I'll pass the examination? And the answer is no. So similarly, for going to Jannah, I require four things: Iman, righteous deed, exhorting people to truth, that is dawah, exhorting people to patience and perseverance. So those people who don't have Iman, even if they get 100 out of 100 in the other aspects of righteous deeds or other things, they shall not go to Jannah. You should pass in all four. That is the reason to go to Jannah. One of the requirements, Iman, is believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you should not do shirk. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 48 and Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 116 that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He pleases, He may forgive any sin, but the sin of shirk He'll never forgive. So anyone who does shirk, and if he dies as a mushrik, mm-hmm. The Quran clearly mentioned that Allah will never forgive him. Before dying, if he accepts Islam and if he stops doing shirk, then inshallah Allah will forgive him.
Inshallah, Doctor. Now, another question would be, how do we tell those who are not performing the prayers? I don't know what we have to admit, my brothers and sisters. Some of us are called Muslims. We are Muslim. We were born Muslims, right, Doctor? But some of us did not before or now, they are not performing the prayers. In fact, the prayer or performing the salah, salawatul khams, is the first thing. The first thing will be asked
after
by Allah. Yes.
The first thing that will be asked about your amal. Mm.
Yes. So how do we tell them? I mean, or how do we, the Muslims who are not praying yet, to perform the prayer, to know the hereafter resurrection?
Our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's mentioned in a hadith of Sahih Muslim, that the difference between Iman and Kufr is Salah. Mm-hmm. So Salah differentiates a human being from being a Muslim and a non-Muslim. So it's a fard. It is the second pillar of Islam after Tawheed. after Tawheed, believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worshipping Him alone and no one else, the second pillar is Salah. And the first thing, as you rightly said, that the first thing Allah will ask you on the day of judgment regarding your amal would be about your Salah. So Salah is the most important factor after Tawheed.
Yes.
And it's compulsory. I've given the lecture on Salah, the programming towards righteousness, where I've spoken about that how should you ask Salah, that in Salah, besides praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're asking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How does it benefit you, not only spiritually, how does it benefit you medically? I've given a full talk on that. Salah, the programming towards righteousness.
Yes,
so if you see this talk, yes, I've given a lecture, Salah, the programming towards righteousness. And this talk gives the detail, how can we inspire those Muslims who are not regular in the Salah that they should pray.
And doctor, how do we face those who are against Islam? I mean, now we are talking about Islam and it's good, the values of Islam, yes, everything is good, everything is just nice, the best of life. I mean, the best way is to have Islam as our way of life. But how do we face those who are against Islam, who are telling that Islam is this and that, the good, the worst? I mean, Islam is like what you said earlier, Islam is terrorist, and so on and so forth.
Whenever any non-Muslim, that is the reason I told you that if you know the answers of the 20 most common questions asked by non-Muslims, they ask the same question, that Islam is a religion of terrorism, Islam is a fundamentalistic,
that
Muslims
words.
Are fundamentalistic, Muslims are terrorists. How do you reply? All these replies are given in my book, the 20 most common questions asked by non-Muslims. It's available on the internet, it's also available in Malay language. And
yes,
I'll give you one example. For example, Muslims are called a fundamentalist. What is the meaning of the word fundamentalist? A fundamentalist by definition means a person who follows the fundamentals. For example, if a person wants to be a good scientist, he should know, follow and practice the fundamentals of science. Unless he is a fundamentalist in the field of science, he cannot be a good scientist. For a person to be a good mathematician, he should know, follow and practice the fundamentals of maths. Unless he is a fundamentalist in the field of maths, he cannot be a good mathematician. You cannot paint all fundamentals with the same brush, that all are good or all are bad. Depending in which field the person is the fundamentalist, you have to label him accordingly. And for example, if there is a fundamentalist doctor whose profession is to save human life, he is good for the society. On the other hand, you have a fundamentalist robber whose profession is to rob people, he is not good for society. You cannot paint all fundamentalists with the same brush, that all are good or all are bad. Depending in which field the person is the fundamentalist, you have to label him accordingly. As far as I am concerned, I am a fundamentalist Muslim and I am proud to be a fundamentalist Muslim, because I know, I follow and I strive to practice the fundamentals of Islam. And I know that there is not a single fundamental of Islam which is against humanity as a whole. There may be certain fundamentals which the non-Muslim may feel is against humanity, but the moment you give them the answer with reason, logic and science, there will not be a single human being who can point out a single fundamental of Islam which is against humanity as a whole. And if you read the Webster dictionary, it says that fundamentalism was a movement that started in the early part of USA by a group of Christian called as Protestant. It was first used to describe a movement of the Christians in the early part of the 20th century. The church initially believed that the message of the Bible was from God. These Protestant Christians, they said that not only is the message of the Bible from God, every word, every letter of the Bible is from God. If someone can prove that this movement is good, that every word of the Bible is from God, then the movement is good. But on the other hand, if someone can prove that every word of the Bible is not from God, then the movement is not a good movement. If you read the Oxford Dictionary, it says that fundamentalist is a person who strictly adheres to the ancient teachings of any religion. But if you read the new revised edition of Oxford Dictionary, there's a slight change. It says that fundamentalist is a person who strictly adheres to the ancient teaching and doctrine of any religion, especially Islam. So the moment you hear the fundamentalist, start thinking of a Muslim. You start thinking that he's an extremist. I say, I'm an extremist. I'm extremely loving, I'm extremely kind, I'm extremely merciful, I'm extremely honest, I'm extremely just. What's wrong in being an extremist in the right direction? We Muslims are apologetic. We go out of the way and say, no, I'm not a fundamentalist, I'm not an extremist. So we have to be a fundamentalist Muslim to be a good Muslim. You have to be extremist, because Quran says you have to be extremist in the right things. Extremely kind, extremely merciful, extremely just, extremely honest. You can't be partly honest. If it benefits you, you're honest. If it does not benefit, you're not honest. So we should know how to turn the tables over. We Muslims should know how to turn the tables over. And all this is there in my book, The Common Question Posed by Non-Muslims.
MashaAllah. Hopefully, brothers and sisters, we will go and find the book of Dr. Zakir Naik. The 20, is it 20?
20 most common questions.
20 most.
The books are many, yes, but this is one book called 20 question. Common questions.
Okay, doctor, the last question from me, last but not least, MashaAllah. What is your view, your opinion about those who are asking for their rights of LGBT, the lesbian, gay, lesbian,
homosexual,
lesbian? Yes, bisexual, yes, gay and transgender. They are hoping for something. They are asking for their rights in the United Nations and so on. So
regarding homosexuality, lesbian and gay. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 32, that do you prefer to go after men in preference to women? Talking about Qawm-e Lut, in Surah Hud, in Qawm-e Lut. So in Islam, homosexuality is prohibited. There is no scope for homosexuality. And all this comes because you have broken the hijab. Previously it wasn't there. Yeah. Homosexuality has come because when you start breaking the hijab and you start freely mixing and you have so many girlfriends and you have so many mistresses, so when you get tired of all these normal things, you want something else, and that's homosexuality comes. Yeah. Homosexuality is not genetic. So that is in Islam, there is a strict punishment of homosexuality. It's a major sin in Islam. Mm-hmm. And according to the Bible also, even according to the Bible, the homosexual should be put to death according to the Bible. So in Islam, it's prohibited, 100% prohibited.
MashaAllah, doctor, another question. When we say about Islam, okay, Islam, and we as Muslims, we have to manage, we have to admit everything considered to Islamic thought, right? So your suggestion, Dr. Zakir, to improve our management, our administration in our agencies, in our departments, including in Malaysia here, when, you know, as you said, Malaysia, the country of Malaysia, known as a multi-religious country. How do we show the management of Islam in this kind of country?
There are courses that we conduct also on time management, on management skills, based on the verses of Quran and Hadith. So if you follow the Quran about the discipline in life, like how we have to offer 5 times salah, when the time for salah is there, Fajr salah is there, so this is called management of time. This is the best. And the best appointment is appointed with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there we learn time management. So if we follow the sunnah of the beloved Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that how do we do things, for example, when you want to enter the road, they knock thrice. If you don't get a reply, go away. All this what we learn today in the Western culture about manners is already was already there at the time of the Prophet. How to treat your neighbors, how to treat your parents, how to help the non-Muslims. So all this is there about management. So the best book of guidance, according to me, is the Quran and the Sahih Hadith.
All right, Doctor. Dr. Zakir Naik, we have come to the end, actually, of our session, our special session, MashaAllah. And Doctor, if you can give your conclusion to our brothers and sisters, fellow viewers, fellow audience, what is your advice to all Muslims, especially here in Malaysia?
My advice to all the Muslims is that they should read the Quran with translation in the language they understand the best and implement on it, on the Quran, the Sahih Hadith. And especially to the people of Malaysia, that the Muslims of Malaysia, you have a good opportunity. You have many non-Muslims living around you, in school, in colleges, in workplaces. You have many non-Muslims, the Hindus, the Christians. You should make it a point that you convey the message of Islam to them. Based on the verse of the Quran of Surah Imran, chapter 3, verse 64, which says, Ta'alaw ila kalimatin sawa'in bayna baynakum. Come to common terms as between us and you. which is the first term, Allah na'budu illallah, that we worship none but Allah. Wala nushrika bihi shay'an, that we associate no partners with him. Wala yattakhidhu ba'duna ba'dan arbaban min dunillah, that we erect not among ourselves lords and patrons other than Allah. Fa'in tawallaw, if then they turn back. Faqulu shadu, say bear witness, bi anna muslimun, that we are Muslims bowing our will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Malaysian Muslims should convey the message of Islam to the non-Muslims. You can read the scripture and prove from their scripture about Tawheed, about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is mentioned in the Bible, which is mentioned in the Hindu scriptures, which is mentioned in the Upanishad, which is mentioned in the Vedas, and try and get them closer to the teachings of Islam. Come to common terms and inshallah they will respect Islam more and they will respect you also more. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
Inshallah, thank you. Thanks a lot, Dr. Zakir Naik, for your kind of giving time to have this special session with us, our exclusive interview with Dr. Zakir Naik. So, my brothers and sisters, we have come to the end of the program, our special session here, and mashallah, I am really fortunate. I'm feeling so glad to have this time, this moment with Dr. Zakir Naik. And for us, my brothers and sisters, fellow audience and fellow viewers, inshallah, we will always remember to what Allah has stated in the Quran. Allah says, "Innama al-mu'minuna ikhwa." Verily, the believers are brothers. Is that right, doctor? So, mashallah. مثل المؤمنين في تودهم وتراحمهم وتعاطفهم كمثل الجسد الواحد. The parable of the believers is like a body. So, mashallah, no matter what races we are, no matter where do we live, what works do we do, when and whatever we going to look for our life, no problem. Because we have to know, we have to put our iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to become the best believers of Allah, and we have to try our best to perform all that Allah's commandments, Allah, and to avoid all that He forbids. Inshallah, may Allah bless us, bestow His blessings and merciful blessings and plenty of blessings, inshallah, and Allah Ta'ala will bless you all, my brothers and sisters. Till meet again, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.